I challenge you to a duel.
Hello and welcome to episode 14 of the Movie Jewel podcast. My name is Peter and I am your host. Each episode of the Movie Jewel podcast, myself and my co-host, will pick a subject based around movies and then each of us will pick a film that we think best represents that subject. The only rule being that we cannot pick a film that has already been discussed on the podcast. On this episode of Movie Jewel podcast, I'll be discussing the worst sci-fi of the 2010s with movie jewelist Nicole Davis. This was the first of our random subject selector, which is a natty little app I've got on the phone that draws up a random subject for myself and one of my co-hosts to discuss. And it was a tremendous amount of fun. We'll be getting to that in a minute. But a few points of order before we get into that. So last time on Movie Jewel, myself and Vanessa Cordner were discussing the worst horror remake, which again was a really fun discussion to have. And I'd just like to shout out and thank a few people for retweets on Twitter. Those are Paul from Filmbusters, Jamie Russell, Jeff Brandon Warner, Movie Drone Podcast, and Ben from Filmbusters as well. So thanks, guys, for retweeting that. And I hope you enjoyed the episode. Some really good feedback, actually, through Twitter and through Facebook as well. I think it really touched on a nerve with a lot of people who got quite involved. We had the poll on Twitter as well, which was a unanimous decision for Vanessa's choice of The Wicker Man, which got 100% as the worst of those two films and the worst horror remake. So well done to Vanessa. And as I've mentioned on the last few episodes, I'd like to sort of bring to your attention another podcast that I've been listening to of late. This one I found quite recently. It's a podcast called It's Not That Bad, hosted by Jason. This looks at B-movies or movies in general that are considered to be bad movies or not great movies at all, and looks for the good, looks for the positive in those films. It's right up my street. I'm a lover of many bad movies or movies that people would consider bad, and I would consider them to be underrated. So, and if you look through their back catalogue, you'll see many a movie that I've probably watched two or three times and really enjoyed. So if you appreciate a good B movie, then definitely check out this podcast, and I'll play a trailer for you now.
You've heard it all before.
Waste of film.
Dumpster fire.
How did this even get made?
Train wreck.
Total garbage.
Snooze fest.
Utterly painful.
Worst film ever.
But is it really? The show is called It's Not That Bad, and we dare to look at the lowest rated shows and movies and see only the good things. We're looking for A grades in B movies. It's Not That Bad. Listen now, wherever you get your podcasts.
Also, I'll drop in some links in the show notes if you want to check out everything over at It's Not That Bad with Jason, then check it out. I encourage you to do so. And then finally, just a reminder about how you can get in touch with us here at the Movie Jewel podcast. So first of all, you can contact us through Twitter, which is at Movie Jewel Pod. We will be posting the selection announcements, letting you know what some upcoming episodes are going to be, and just general thoughts and musings about various different things in the world of Twitter. But also, you can contact us through the Facebook page, which is facebook.com/Movie Jewel Podcast. Again, on there, we post the selection announcements to let you know what subjects are coming up and what movies are going to be selected for those. Give you a chance to watch them before the episode drops, and also let you know where you can watch them, whether they're streaming as part of a subscription or they're going to be showing on certain platforms. And then finally, you can contact us at moviejewelpodcast@gmail.com on email. Get in touch with us if anything you want to suggest, give us some feedback, let us know about what you'd like to hear, and things like that, then we welcome it. If you feel so kind enough as to leave us a review or a rating on any of your the podcast platforms that you use, then that's much appreciated. And thank you again to anybody who's done that. And without further ado, we'll get into the main episode, in which we're going to be discussing the worst science fiction of the 2010s. So, welcome back to Nicole Davis. Nicole, how are you?
I'm well. I'm a little burned out on 2010 science fiction at this point, but otherwise, I'm doing well.
Excellent, excellent. So, you been up to anything interesting lately? Any watching any good watches? Anything that sort of tickled your fancy other than terrible sci-fi films from the 2010s?
Any good watches? That's a good question. Today I watched Tentacles, which is a Jaws ripoff from the 1970s with right. John Huston and Henry Fonda, with his part edited in from around his pool somewhere in California.
Is that a bit like Raymond Burr in the Godzilla, where they just...
A little bit, yes. Yeah. A lot of... It's an Italian production, and a lot of Italian productions do that. They'll get an American celebrity by, you know, editing in their footage from elsewhere into their film.
There were a lot of those sort of Jaws ripoffs that seemed to attract some relatively big stars. I mean, I remember, I think the film was called Orca with
yes.
Richard Harris. Mm-hmm. And there was what was it, The Last Shark? I think it was an Italian sort of ripoff with, not that he's a massive star, but he was what's his name? James something. He was the replacement for Charlton Heston in the second Planet of the Apes film, James Franciscus or something like that.
Oh, yep.
But both of those films are awful.
Yes.
All I remember from Orca is that there's something with a killer whale fetus and early on in the film, and just very bizarre film. Yeah,
that would be a category to have at some point, is animal attack movies.
That aren't Jaws.
That aren't Jaws. Right. Well, I mean, that's the natural, you know, top level there. You want to peel that out of contention early.
Okay, so last time you were here, we were talking good films gone bad, Face Off and... Oh God, Batman Forever, which was a lot of fun, and as we sort of discussed off mic, we seem to have had a bit of a bad run, or you do, with the Movie Jewel podcast so far, because you said three out of the four episodes that you've done have been worst, or looking at films that aren't that good.
As good as we thought they were, yes.
And I put it to you a couple of months ago, asking for a guinea pig for a new concept for the podcast. So a random subject generator, which was a very high class app on my phone. And that spewed out for us the worst science fiction film of the 2010s.
Yes, it was luck of the draw. So I can't really blame anyone for that.
Just out of interest, though, if I'd landed on best, what would you have gone for?
Oh, good heavens. Probably either Annihilation or Interstellar.
Okay, cool.
So maybe Ex Machina would be in contention there. But there's been a lot of fantastic science fiction in the 2010s. But as I discovered, there's a lot of dreck as well.
You know, I was brought up on sci-fi. My grandma loved sci-fi, and we used to watch Battlestar Galactica and, you know, Knight Rider. I know that's maybe not as advanced as that, but, you know, I was brought up on that, really, and I was a young man. So, you know, it's in that sort of time space, it was not music to my ears, but music to my eyes, I suppose.
No, I loved science fiction as well, so...
But it's something that I've not necessarily been drawn to in my later years. I think maybe I had my fill when I was younger. So I hadn't actually watched a hell of a lot of sci-fi from that time period. But to give you a few little snippets about science fiction in the 2010s, the highest rated sci-fi of the decade on Rotten Tomatoes was Mad Max Fury Road, which I suppose...
I don't know if I'd call that science fiction. I mean, it's dystopian future, but it's not science-based. You know, the plot doesn't have anything to do with scientific advancements.
Yeah, I guess. But I was quite surprised.
But I mean, I can't disagree. Fury Road's fantastic film.
97% on Rotten Tomatoes. And I mean, that's after... God, when did that come out? 2015. I've still not watched the entirety of it. I've tried three times to watch that film and I've only got halfway through.
Well, you don't get to the part where they turn around and come back the other way yet.
That's when it really gets going. I need to. I've talked about this before on the podcast, but it took me... There's a few films that I think are absolutely brilliant. You know, it's taken me a couple of... two or three tries to try and get through it and get to the end. And that's just one of those films, and I still need to get to the end so I can make an actual decision about it, because the general consensus is that it's amazing. So I need to get to that. The highest grossing science fiction film of the 2010s was... Would you like to hazard a guess?
Is it one of the Transformers movies?
Nope. Star Wars Force Awakens.
Oh, I should have known that.
With $2.071 billion worldwide. That's just a ridiculous amount of money. And the only science fiction film during the 2010s to pick up Worst Picture at the Golden Raspberry Awards. It's a little bit of a stretch, but Fantastic Four in 2015. Which, I mean, I suppose it is one of the more science fiction-y comic book stories, I suppose, aren't they? They're very much entrenched in science, their characters.
Yeah, I could see that. That's actually one that I thought about watching, but I would have had to pay money, and I wasn't going to do that.
Do you know what? I don't see... I mean, yes, compared to a lot of the superhero movies and comic book movies that we've had in the last 15 years, it's not the best. But I didn't think it was as bad as everybody made out. It gets a bit of a mess towards the end, and you can tell that there was a lot of changes and maybe studio interference and whatever, and the casting's off a little bit. But I don't think it deserved the nailing it got from the critics. I didn't think, but there we go. Yeah. Okay, so did you... Obviously, you watched a lot more in preparation for this podcast than me. But did it turn out to be an easy choice for you?
Oh boy! Do you want me to go through the list here?
Skim through it. Yes.
There were a couple that I had already seen that I considered. I've seen Chappie, which is on many lists of worst of. Robot Overlords, I didn't think very highly of, but I gave it extra points because it's really, I think, oriented more at children than an adult crowd. So I watched, these are all new watches to me, the rest of these, that I watched just to make sure that, you know, they were really the worst, or see if they were not the worst.
That's dedication, Nicole.
Yeah. So I watched Green Lantern. I watched Lucy, which is that movie where Scarlett Johansson uses 100% of her brain. After Earth, Last Days on Mars, Serenity, the 2019 movie, Transcendence, and Apollo 18. And the closest one that came to the winner was Last Days on Mars, because it's mostly just kind of grim and dull. You know, it's zombies on Mars, basically.
Yeah. I mean, I must admit, a couple of those. I mean, Green Lantern is yeah, it's not fantastic, but I think it that, a bit like Fantastic Four, got a worse rap than it deserved, I think.
I agree. Most of these got a worse rap than they deserved. Green Lantern was at least colorful, and Ryan Reynolds is charming. Lucy had a really interesting idea, even though you could argue that it's the same movie as Limitless, a drug that lets you access more of your brain, but it goes in a lot of different directions than Limitless does.
Well, there's a lot of those. I mean, there's, I can't remember, is it called Hannah? I think about the girl
who's... Who's, like, raised to be an assassin or something.
Yeah, there was a lot of that during this sort of time period, really, sort of kids or people that are thrown into these, you know, espionage-y, spy-y type sort of kick-ass kind of stories, and there was a lot of that during this period, or people that are on drugs and that have enhanced them and all that sort of stuff.
Right, and Lucy is directed by Luc Besson, so it's going to be visually interesting, it's going to have good action sequences in it. It goes into some really oddball places near the end, and I was like, okay, weird, but I'm with you. We'll see. Interesting to see where this is going. After Earth was not nearly as bad as I was told it was going to be. Maybe I had the advantage here of hearing all these films with terrible reputations, and so my expectations were rock bottom for all of these. So anything above rock bottom was an improvement. But After Earth is, you know, it's some interesting ideas. It's an interesting plot. It's just that Jaden Smith, at least at this point in his career, was not a great actor. I am sad to say. I think he tried, but I think that M. Night should have had him do a couple more takes in some scenes. I was like, this is what they went with, really.
Oh, he's After Earth, M. Night Shyamalan?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Okay, I didn't realize that. That probably explains why it's bad then.
You know. Oh, you were asking what good movies I saw. I watched The Visit. The Visit was a lot of fun.
Oh, The Visit's amazing.
That's M. Night Shyamalan. So,
yeah, that's a definite high point in the last 10 years for M. Night.
Right.
Although I did enjoy Split. Split's quite good. I like Split. So,
yeah, Transcendence was just kind of boring. I turned that off about halfway through. Serenity starts out as like a neo-noir, and then there's a turn, and then there's a science fiction element in it. And I'm not going to spoil what that is if you haven't seen it, because it is bananas where this goes.
Excellent.
And Apollo 18, I actually enjoyed.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a sucker for found footage. I do like a good found footage, and it's not bad.
Yeah, I had no idea it was a found footage type movie. If I had known that, I might have gone to see that in the theater, and I might have enjoyed it a little bit more. As it was, I watched it on YouTube. And again, you know, a lot of these movies have interesting concepts. Yeah. They just aren't executed terribly well. So this had a good concept. It's just, I don't think it had a high enough budget to execute it in a way that looked really great and convincing.
Yeah, but then I think, as we're going to find out from both of our choices,
even a big budget,
just because you've got a big budget, it doesn't mean you're going to make a good film.
That did prove true, yes, with both of our choices.
So what did you go for in the end?
I ended up choosing 2017's Geostorm, which should have an exclamation point at the end of it, honestly. That should have been right in the title.
The Senate committee will now hear from Jacob Lawson, Climate ISS Chief Coordinator. May the record reflect that he was nearly 1 hour late.
Yeah, sorry about that. I literally had to fly in from outer space.
Thanks to a system of satellites, natural disasters have become a thing of the past. We can control our weather.
Mr. President, one of our thermospheric satellites malfunctioned over Afghanistan.
So your proposal is what?
We shut down all satellites.
I don't need to remind all of you how many people died from catastrophic climate conditions.
make sure there's no further incidents.
Are you going back up to space?
I'm coming back. I promise.
Have a safe trip, sir.
Just don't touch anything.
Main engine start.
This is Mr. Jake Lawson.
The Jake Lawson?
You look much older than I would have thought.
I mean, you look good. Am I getting fired? My access has been blocked.
So satellite has a bad comm, that happens.
Not a satellite, all of them.
This wasn't a malfunction. It was intentional.
There's potential for catastrophic weather events on a global scale.
A geostorm. We have to shut the system down.
As the kill codes is the president.
I need your help.
You're soliciting a Secret Service agent. Seriously? We're kidnapping the president in a self-driving cab.
Jake, if you can't stop it, no one can. 3, 2, 1.
Come on, baby.
You're committing treason.
Oh, yeah, I kidnapped the president. I've stolen state secrets.
Yeah, anything I'm forgetting, honey?
Honey.
Hold on!
Marry her.
Gerard Butler, Jim Sturgis, I want to say, as like his little brother. They're both Americans, but they cover up the accents by saying at one point that they were both born in the UK. So, which explains why their American accents get spotty in places. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm like, oh, good cover, good cover. That was a good idea by somebody.
So. Yeah. I mean, even being English, Butler's American accent is always a bit tricky.
Dodgy.
Is probably the polite way of putting it. Yes.
So I don't know why they couldn't have just been British scientists, but I what do I know?
Well, that's it, isn't it? Yeah, I've had this argument with many a film that we've discussed on the Movie Joe podcast. You know, it's an international story.
Mm-hmm.
His character could quite easily have been Scottish,
right?
Because he is obviously Scottish, and we've already discovered from PS I Love You that he does a very dodgy Irish accent. He must be the only Scotsman who does a dodgy Irish accent. Sean Connery, to be fair, does a dodgy
They're
Irish.
They're like two sides of the same coin, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Or if they wanted to insist on having, you know, because part of the point of the underpinning of the story is that it is an American project and people are trying to keep American control over the, you know, the oversight of the project, that they could have cast American actors in these two roles and chose not to.
Mm-hmm.
Probably because these guys were less expensive is my guess, and they wanted to save money for the effects. I don't know, but yeah, basically Geostorm is, you know, global weather events are getting more extreme, so we have the world has clubbed together and bought and built a network of satellites and a gigantic, like, insanely gigantic space station, big enough to have a production floor for these giant, like, oil tanker-sized satellites. Yeah,
like a net. What do they call? Is it the Danish boy? Is that what it's called?
Dutch boy.
Dutch boy, that's it.
Yes. Mm. So, and I noticed they phrased it as the boy who put his finger in the dam to hold back a flood, and I'm like, didn't want to say dyke, did you? Okay.
No.
Yeah. So, and something starts going wrong with the satellite network and blah, 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 blah. So, you know, we are going to do spoilers for this, correct?
Oh, God, yes.
Yeah. Okay. So if you haven't seen
really
it.
Is there really much to spoil in this?
I was going to say, if you haven't seen it, maybe don't.
Yeah.
Or this is one maybe watch with friends and you can throw things at the screen and make fun of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it turns out, of course, it's sabotaged because the Secretary of State wants to keep American control of it. So they can eliminate their global enemies using the satellites. Well. And then tomorrow the sun will rise and our enemies will be gone. I'm turning the clock back to 1945 when America was a shining city on a hill.
God.
Could they be more obvious who they are calling out to making America great again?
Yeah.
And the shining city on a hill is a motif that Ronald Reagan used in his speeches all the time.
Well, this is a question I wanted to ask you as obviously an American, because a lot of obviously this film is directed by Dean Devlin, who's the sort of on-off producing partner of Roland Emmerich, who we'll discuss a little bit later on. I don't know if this was his debut. Was it his debut directing?
It is his debut as a director.
And obviously a lot of criticism that was thrown at past sort of Emmerich-Devlin collaborations was being very pro-America.
Mm.
Do you think this film almost goes out of its way to be less pro-America?
Yes, I would definitely say that. But I suspect...
To its detriment?
No, I don't think to its detriment.
Okay.
I think it's... The problem is that it's still mostly Americans who are the saviors in the end,
mm-hmm.
who fix everything and get everything going correctly again. But yeah, I do think they went out of the way. I think some of it is cynical, though. I think it was so they could get more international funding and distribution by making it more globally appealing.
Yeah.
They make a point of saying that it was the US and China who did most of the building and funding, that they were the leaders of this project with 17 countries. They note that it's 17 countries multiple times.
Yeah.
So, yes, I would say that they definitely went out of the way to make it less rah-rah America.
It does always seem to be that the, you know, especially, you know, and there's a lot of comparisons to this to Day After Tomorrow, 2012, which are obviously past Roland Emmerich, Dean Devlin sort of films. It does seem to be a trend that Asia gets the worst of it first.
Yeah, Tokyo and Hong Kong kind of get a bad end of the stick there.
But it is always, yes, definitely.
I did find it kind of hilarious that they cast, you know, of the international cast, the one American they cast as a Chinese man in Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm.
So, because Daniel Wu is American. So, I mean, obviously he's of Chinese ancestry and he does make a lot of films in East Asia.
Yeah.
But he was born here. So, it's like, that's... I just thought that was kind of funny.
Yeah.
I mean, isn't Abby Cornish British also? She plays the Secret Service girlfriend.
Yes, I believe she is, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, the Secret Service Barbie, as she's called in this film.
She does have that perfectly coiffed blonde hair at all times.
Oh.
Hey, everybody. Nicole in the editing bay. I looked it up. Abby Cornish is Australian. Sorry about that.
One bit, whether you pick this up, I don't know, but... Those two characters, her and, is it Max?
Max Lawson is Jim Sturgess's character, yes.
They're the two most unlikable characters in this film. And they're supposed to be your sort of anchor point on Earth and what's going on Earth. And they're just constantly unlikable throughout the whole film.
I would agree with that.
And it just completely, all the way through, I was thinking, these two, well... Max is just a massive arsehole from the start, and you can't get on board with him. I had no sympathy for him whatsoever. Obviously, from the start, he's portrayed to be this sort of yes man, really, for the government, and you know, and obviously Jake Lawson is supposed to be this sort of wild character and you know, doesn't give a shit about anything other than obviously saving the planet. But he doesn't play the game. He just does what he wants to do.
Right. But his motives are pure.
Yeah, exactly. But it's just those two characters, I just didn't like them at all. I mean, I think it's set up that you maybe don't trust her in the first half of the film, because I really thought that she was going to turn out to be a bad guy and It was her that was tipping off the, the protagonists of the film, antagonists of the film, about where everybody was and what was happening and things like that. But obviously that didn't come to fruition. Whether that was a plot point that was maybe considered, I don't know. But yeah, they're just massively unlikable, really unlikable. And Jake Lawson's not much better.
No, he's not a lot better. He's sort of, he's the renegade who speaks his mind and doesn't respect a lot of these government bureaucrats, but like entirely to the detriment of his project.
Yeah.
Like if you work in Washington, D.C., I lived in the D.C. area for a few years. And everything centers around the U.S. government there. Like almost every business caters to it. And you have to play the game. Yeah. You absolutely have to suck up to certain people if you want to get your thing done. Whatever your thing is, you have to play nice.
Yeah.
And everyone who lives and works there knows it. And if you don't, you get kicked out fast. So that's one of the, of all the improbable things in this movie. It's one of the many improbable things. I mean, I literally would be here days rattling off a list of the improbable or in fact impossible things. In this film, but he's they're very exaggerated character types from the get-go. You know, Gerard Butler comes to this meeting and he's an hour late, and of course the bureaucrats being nasty and snippy about him being an hour late, he's like, oh, sorry, I had to fly in from outer space to be here. And his brother gives this long suffering sigh and is texting him, you know, like, please play along, please, you know, shut up, roll over, let them say what they're going to say. And so then after this hearing, they stop talking to each other for 3 years because Jake Lawson gets pulled off the project because he's not playing nice. So, you know, and then you get the introduction of Secret Service agent girlfriend with this unfunny banter between two bland white people in a corridor. And apparently, even in the last 3 years, Max Lawson couldn't find somebody to give him a better haircut.
No, I've made a note about this because he boasts about having a new tie and looking different. And she says something about looking different. And it's like, you've got the same haircut as you've had 3 years ago. Most people maybe change up a little bit after 3 years. Maybe.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Most women I know, you find something that works for you, you stick with it. But that haircut does not work for him.
No. But also, if you're going to portray the passage of time, especially in movies,
change
new haircut, it's a good way to do that.
Right. It's a really easy indicator that it some time has passed. And instead, everyone looks exactly the same.
Yeah. Especially if you're a government official and you're not a influencer.
Right. So, and then there's a freak cold snap in Afghanistan and they have this emergency meeting. What's going wrong? And of course, if anybody had listened to Mayor Winningham at the beginning, why is she here? This movie is so far beneath her. But if Mayor Winningham plays, I guess, a senator or some other cabinet member who's arguing that they need to shut down the satellite network immediately. And we find out at the end of the film that the only way to fix the network, which has a virus in it, is to turn everything off and then on again, because they've watched the IT crowd. Have you tried turning it off and then on again? You know, it's if they had listened to her at the beginning, everything would have been fixed. Thousands of, if not tens of thousands of lives would have been saved.
Yeah.
But no one listens to the smart woman. No one has learned a thing from Alien. So they got Mayor Winningham there for like 3 minutes.
You've got this really annoying kid as well, who's Jake Lawson's daughter.
Oh, yes. She's the one who gives the child exposition dump at the beginning.
Oh, my God. It's just this really condescending narration at the start, isn't it? Like,
yes. And they steal this. Roland Emmerich stole this for Moonfall, where you have the child of the protagonist gives narration.
I've put that out of my mind because that's even worse.
Oh, yeah. Moonfall is terrible.
I'll tell you what it reminded me of. Obviously, it's better in what I'm thinking of, but it reminded me of The Crow. There's the girl who has the narration at the top and the end of the film, which was a hell of a lot better than this. But she swears a lot and she has these really clever comebacks to various different people at the start of the film. And to me, I don't know whether it's just because my daughter's that sort of age where, you know, they're quite impressionable and you're teaching them about what's appropriate and what isn't appropriate. Mm-hmm. And, you know, yes, you might hear somebody say that, but you shouldn't say it kind of thing. I don't know. Maybe that's just in my head at the moment. And I didn't really sort of find that funny. It was just a bit like, really? But then she doesn't appear until 20 minutes before the end, after the first 15 minutes. She's not mentioned until the stakes are way up here.
No, she's the primary motivator. You know, she's the one Jake Lawson's trying to save more than anybody else on the planet. He's trying to save his daughter. So it's just like, well, that's great and all. But there are, you know, several other billion people who could use some assistance at this point.
Exactly. It doesn't need that character. Yes, it raises the stakes for Jake, but surely, you know, the entire planet is enough of a stake for Jake.
Right. So things start going wrong. Max suggests that they get a team together to assess the problem and fix it. And the president says, no, I want you to get one guy. Why? I don't know.
Because we've paid X amount of millions of dollars to Gerard Butler.
Right. I guess. So that's who Max Lawson goes to get, because who knows more about this system than the man who built it? His brother, Jake Lawson, who is acting like a complete asshole as soon as his brother shows up. It's like, yes, your brother didn't support you after you got fired, but that's not really his fault. And yet you're blaming him for the loss of your job and your house and your marriage and most of the custody of your child. And just like, you know, take a little responsibility, dude. You know, just a little bit.
Just low key gaslighting. Just take responsibility for your own actions.
Yeah. It's just like, you did this to me. Oh, really? But, anyway, so his brother tells him what's going on, and he agrees to come back, and they put him on a shuttle by himself back up to the space station in this massive waste of resources. Like, you don't even have, you know, other crew going up. They don't put any cargo in the shuttle with him to take up to the station.
This is just like, I'm sure maybe this is one of the things that you could just throw at the unrealism of this film and how unrealistic it is. You know, they've just got these shuttles lined up to take off. And it's like, they can't be more than, you know, a few meters away from each other. And surely, you know,
they knock one another over when they launched. Yes, I counted 16.
16, Jesus.
That were visible in the shot. And they're all on what I thought were, like, when the space shuttle launches in Florida, the last thing they do is they bring it upright and then they transport it the rest of the way upright to the launch pad. But from what I can tell, they are launching them from these transports directly, which you cannot do. Just cannot. No, the worst, I think the absolute worst sin of this movie, and I know it's the obvious one that I should overlook for everything to work, is the size and expense of this satellite network. I honestly don't think there are enough resources, materials, or money on the planet to create, launch, maintain this network in this utterly gigantic space station that not only do you have to have it this big and operational and stabilized on its own and fuel it and everything, but you have to have the oxygen in there. You know, you've got to have the air, you've got to have the air exchanges. And for some reason, they have full showers and gravity.
Yeah.
Even though the whole thing isn't rotating at all times. They don't address the gravity problem in any way.
No.
And there's thousands, literally thousands of these satellites in a network in a like a Dyson sphere kind of formation.
Yeah.
And if even one goes slightly wrong, it's going to knock the entire thing out of kilter. And somehow, somehow they've built this thing that's impossible to build. And we don't have the resources to build or maintain. And in addition to getting everyone to cooperate to make it in the first place, but it's been built perfect from minute one.
This is the problem. And I think this spans both of our choices as well, is maybe a little less with mine, but I'm sure we'll get onto that, is that, yes, you've got to, with any science fiction, with most films, you've got to suspend your disbelief when it comes to the fantastic. But if you're going to do that and you're going to have that advancement in technology and everything else, then as far as I can see, this film is set in the here and now. It's set in the very not too distant future. There's nothing that ages this film past the next 5 years or something like that. But you don't have that. This is it's set in modern times, as this is modern technology, and this is where we are and where we can be in the next 5 to 10 years, and we're nowhere near that.
Yes, exactly.
So it's too much of a stretch to think that we can have this net across the world
that somehow has technology that does not exist for like sonic waves to affect the weather or heat or whatever it is that they're doing to give weather control, which, you know, some people, at least in my country, will tell you is not only possible but happening, that there are weather control satellites right now. But, you know, they tend to be the tinfoil hat crowd.
Well, if they can control it to be a bit bloody cooler here, then that would be fantastic.
So,
well, I think one of the showpieces of this film is the disasters and you know what happens in this film. But to me, as a first time viewing, because it was a first time viewing for me, there was nothing that hasn't been done before,
right?
Yeah. Whether it's 2012 or it's Day After Tomorrow
has the running from the cold sequence.
Yeah, everything's there, and I just kept thinking to myself. And it wasn't until after I'd watched it and then I sort of read up on it a little bit that it, you know, realised that it was, or at the end credits, that it was Dean Devlin, who obviously I knew was a main partner of Roland Emmerich and all, you know, in all of those films and everything else. And it just seemed like a really bizarre choice to make for your directorial debut, is to retread things that you've done in the past. It's like Simon and Garfunkel splitting up. And then Art Garfunkel going away and rewriting A Bridge Over Troubled Water and changing three words. It just felt like really lazy.
Yes.
Incredibly lazy. It's like, yes, I can do a disaster film because that's what I'm comfortable with, but I'll add this tiny bit of science fiction to throw over the top and make it a little bit different.
Yeah, it's a remix album. Basically, of previous disaster movies.
Yeah.
So, with just a little more space.
But it's got some of those standards, hasn't it? It's got a dog that's in peril, that's saved at the end. It's got this presidential storyline with Andy Garcia, who seems to just play authority figures these days. I don't know if, unless I'm missing things, but everything I've seen him in recently, he seems to be playing these sort of authority figures and important people or heads of certain departments and things like that.
Or Ed Harris, who is now playing most of the time playing bad guys of one variety or another, which made him instantly suspect.
I mean, I couldn't stop staring at his frown lines. They went on forever.
Yeah, they've gotten deep.
Jeez, yeah. It was like a Cornish pasty. Just Klingon. Just kept going and going. Like an infinity mirror, is it? Or something. Just went on forever. But yeah, poor old Ed Harris.
It's not great. They have... This movie's packed with tropes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, at first you think the Indian crew member who helps pull the Afghanistan satellite is a bad guy because he sends the other people away and copies something off the satellite's hard drive. So you think it's the evil brown guy trope. And then he walks past the head of security, who is the French guy, Doucette, and he is Red Herring Man, because you think maybe he's the evil guy. It's packed wall to wall. It's packed wall to wall. And Jake gets up there and has the trope of insulting the commander as soon as he gets there, because he doesn't let the woman get a word in edgewise. And it's just, oh my goodness.
What did you think of the effects in this film?
For the most part, they were actually pretty good. I'm trying to think of where they were spotty. Probably the freezing effects, where people are running and freezing. It's like, nobody knows what that would look like, though.
There was a bit where this, where they get the, I think, on the Dutch boy. Is that the space station or is that the net? I can't remember what they're called, the space station.
I think it's meant to be the entire network is Dutch boy.
When they're on there and they get the one of the satellites into the main sort of thing, and then it goes crazy and...
Yes.
That was a bit spotty, I thought. Okay. I thought that was a bit...
Yes, you're correct there. And that is the second biggest sin against science, if you ask me. But everything moves too fast. Like, these huge robotic arms are moving incredibly fast and dexterously.
Yeah.
And that doesn't happen. Like, towards the end of the film, one of the shuttles catches a satellite on the fly as they're both about to re-enter Earth's atmosphere. And it, anybody who's watched footage, you know, any of NASA's footage of the robot arm at work, it moves incredibly slowly, both just because of how it functions and for safety reasons. You don't want inertia taking over and punching a hole in your spaceship. You know, you want to have a million fail safes built in, and you don't want it to move at speed. There's too high a chance for injury when stuff that big moves that fast. Yeah, and it swings the satellite around and everyone has to duck, and
I mean, one of the other really bad points from this film is that it pulls in the worst Robert Sheehan performance
ever. That's a shame.
And I love Robert Sheehan.
He's so good in Misfits.
He's so good in Misfits, so good in The Umbrella Academy. He's good in most of the bit parts he's had in films, even some of the terrible ones. What's the one with Nicolas Cage? Is it The Last Witch Hunter or is that Vin Diesel? Season of the Witch.
Yes.
Season of the Witch, I'm thinking of. You know, he's a shining star in most of the things he's in, but this is just fucking terrible. He's absolutely wasted and he's got the dodgiest of London accents.
Yeah, I had to look that up. I'm like, oh, he's Irish. Okay.
I think he's meant to be sort of Cockney in this film, I think. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure he got paid well for it.
Yes. I think that's why a lot of people do these films, is it's like, oh, big disaster movie.
I mean, I reviewed this on Letterboxd, and I gave it 2 stars, which is maybe a little bit generous, but 0.5 star for some of the effects, because I think some of the effects are pretty good. I think the smart car chase action set piece through Hong Kong. Is it Hong Kong?
Yes.
It was okay, and I thought it was quite interesting to see that through the eyes of a smart car rather than just, you know, some big sort of SUV and things like that. And I gave it one star just because it's got Zazie Beetz in it.
Also colossally wasted.
Who I think is just amazing. She's massively wasted, but she's still the best thing in this film. But she disappears halfway through. She's mentioned in the last third of the film, but she isn't seen. Massively wasted. And the other half of a star was for being under 2 hours as well.
Just under, yeah.
Mercifully. It's quite a short film.
But yeah.
Compared to a lot of these kind of disaster films.
Zazie Beetz works in the State Department building with Max, which actually they get the geography correct here. The State Department building is in what's called the Harry S. Truman building, which is on the Capitol Mall near the Lincoln Memorial. So there's an establishing shot at one point that shows the mall and then shows you Max at work. They had to pick these little generic names for these two characters, and I just kept getting them confused.
Yeah.
But yeah, he brings... Max goes to find his favorite hacker, who is Dana, played by Zazie Beetz, and she's analyzing why his holoframe, the hard drive / phone / portable translucent collapsible display that does not exist and cannot exist. she analyzes it and, like, literally, she finds the issue in, I sat and counted 17 seconds flat. She finds out what's wrong. So he talks to his brother and they talk about sabotage at high levels of government on an unsecured line to each other between space and the ground. And somehow these two supposedly very smart people don't realize that this line is monitored by many people.
Well, that's it. I think, you know, it's a very lazy script.
Yes.
And I think that's a big problem with this film. And that's really highlighted in the fact that the big sort of showdown / reveal of the film, that Ed Harris is the one who's controlling everything. Mm. He's the one who's wanting to, keep the Dutch boy within America's control and everything else. It's all done at the side of the road.
Yeah.
In a lay-by.
Yeah.
It's a massive sort of anti-climax, really. You know, there's no big reveal in front of the rest of the authorities and everything else. It's like, yeah.
Yeah, every big reveal happens sort of isolated from everyone else. Like, they find out that, you know, Jake finds out that Duncan is the guy who planted the virus that's making the network go wonky. But no one sees the confrontation between the two of them. And then they go to try to find the hard drive, and Red Herring Man comes out and holds them at gunpoint because he wanted to see who was going to come to find this. And I have giant all caps in my notes. Why are there guns on a space station?
Yeah,
because that is the most colossally bad idea anyone has ever had. Back on Earth, the guy in Hong Kong figures out why everything is going wrong and is about to tell Max when he gets killed in a hit and run, and the Secret Service agent could shoot the car that ran him over, has a wide open field, no civilians are in the crossfire. She absolutely could have shot that car and tried to disable it, and does not take the shot. So that's...
See, this is why I thought she was in on it.
Yeah.
But she wasn't, but there we go.
Right. She just doesn't take the shot. And it's, you know, after that happens, Jake calls to quote-unquote apologize to his brother Max, but then tells him this coded story about going fishing with his father that he must have sat down because of the way this stupid-ass code works, sat down and written it out word for word, counting on his brother not to interrupt him so that he doesn't have any extra words in there that, to throw the number count off. So he tells this whole story, talking about his father dropping his cell phone in Key Biscayne, which tells his brother that the key to this code is their father's cell phone number, which somehow both of them remember, because I don't remember anybody's cell phone number because it's programmed into my phone.
Well, nobody does now. So, I only remember mine because it's so easy to remember because it repeats itself, literally.
Right. So Max takes this conversation to his... He realizes it's a code. He takes the conversation to the hacker, tells her what the code is, and somehow she manages to... Yeah, it has to do with this is the first word, and then one word after that's the first digit of phone number, and the next digit is 8. So 8 words after that. I'm like, well, would it be 8 words after, or is it after another 8 words, or where do you start counting from? Which one counts as the first word of the message? Is it Key Biscayne? Is that the first word? Or is it come after that phrase? So I would think there's so many ways you could get this wrong.
I'd have eternally fallen out with my brother for coming up with such a convoluted code. I'd be like, just fucking tell me.
Right. And so he takes his hacker back to his hacker friend, his pet hacker, Dana, back to his house, where it passes the Bechdel test when the white girlfriend mistakes the black professionally dressed woman for a burglar rather than a guest of her boyfriend, which I did not love.
No.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Could have been done better. And then he suborns his girlfriend to use her credentials to get secret files out of the White House, which they screen you for that stuff in the Secret Service. They do psych screenings so that sort of thing can't happen. But this is the point in my second viewing of this movie that I realized that either this script was much dumber and was doctored to try to put in smarter details, or it used to be much smarter and it's been dumbed way down for the audience. And either way, I'm angry. So,
I mean, it's just so convoluted. So convoluted. The whole of this storyline is just,
There's a reason it would be the State Department. There's an actual reason. There's an actual bureau in the State Department. I looked it up. Why would the State Department be involved in this kind of thing? There's a bureau called the Bureau of Oceans and International Environmental and Scientific Affairs, which covers things like environment and climate and things that are of global environmental issues, like what's happening now and what Dutch boys meant to fix. And I'm like, that's smart. They know which...
Well, you've got this sort of bureaucracy storyline that started with Richard Schiff's character as this sort of, I think he's a senator, isn't
he? Evil bureaucrat.
Yeah, at the start. And then he never appears for the rest of the film.
No, never again. They bring him in just to be a hard ass.
And he's, you know, Richard Schiff's a relatively well-known character actor from America. And he's just, there's just no mention of him for the rest of the film.
No.
And that doesn't play a part in anything else.
Nope.
For the duration.
Nope. There's a lot of characters like that.
Yeah.
Show up for 2 minutes.
Including Zazie Bates.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is such a waste. And so he suborns his girlfriend with the classic line, "You know this is bigger than you and me." And the only way to get rid of the virus, like I said, is to turn it off.
And then turn it on again.
And the only way they can turn off the satellites is with the president's fingerprints and retina scans.
Of course.
And so they have to kidnap the president of the United States. They have to convince a Secret Service agent to kidnap the president of the United States. Oh, I'm just grimacing through the entire rest of the movie from here on out. And it's just excruciating.
Well, that's it, really. The rest of the film just becomes...
trope after trope after trope.
Yes, I'm gonna sacrifice myself. I don't need to sacrifice myself because we've come up with a suitable MacGuffin to make sure that I don't have to do that.
We can somehow this satellite is hollow on the inside, and we can get in it for safety.
Yes,
and
kindly German scientist hasn't left. Hasn't left yet,
which is
so,
good.
You know, the Germans are great as well.
Because she's got the code for the doors. Thank God for Uta. So, yeah. So, third biggest sin of the movie is that the president is able to get all 10 fingerprints scanned in one go, because I just had my fingerprints scanned for one of our clients at work to have them on file for security, and it took 8 tries to do my left thumb, and just... took multiple tries for every finger to get a clean scan that the computer would accept. And the president does it all at once, and it's just, sure.
Yeah, well,
so for me personally, that was one of the biggest.
You can't get a clean fingerprint on the first try, but we can put a net across the world to control the weather.
I mean, they could have used that to increase the tension that the fingerprint scanner wasn't reading fingerprints properly. Could have thrown
Add
that in.
A little bit of realism, yeah.
But of course, they get it uploaded with 3 seconds left to go before the geostorm happens. And somehow, even though the cascade has gotten to the point where you're 3 seconds away from geostorm, if you stop it 3 seconds away, the cascade will stop instantaneously. Everything goes back to normal. The Burj Khalifa does not fall over. And...
of course.
Do they wear Speedos in Dubai? I have my doubts.
I don't know. It's that hot here at the moment. I wish I was in Speedos, but I would not put you through that, Nicole.
Oh, goodness. It's just, like I said off before we were recording, I wouldn't know. Your camera's only from the chest up, so just don't tell me if you decide to do that at some point.
No.
But yeah, we have the macho declaration. How did I know it was you, Secretary of State? Because I am the goddamn President of the United States. That's how I knew. Not because I was briefed. So why are the kill codes only transferred to a hard drive and not the mainframe in the space station? Like, why do they manually have to run it from one end of the station to the other? No reason. Geostorm stops instantly once the kill codes are in there. Why is there room for 2 people inside of a satellite? The nimble shuttle, which grabs the satellite with its nimble robot arms. And then the Burj Khalifa is leaning, but okay. The dog in Mumbai is safe. 6 months later, Max and Jake take Hannah fishing. Ha ha, it sucks and is boring. exiting narration.
Is that just your general summarization of the film? It sucks and it's boring.
That too. it's a general wrap up of both fishing and this story. and the wrap up narration is, we share one future. We will survive.
Christ.
So apparently, I don't know. I wish I had more detail on this. Apparently, the test screenings of this went poorly. So there were some rewrites and reshoots, but I do not know which parts were rewritten and reshot. But, oh, this movie just made me so angry.
Well, it's like I said earlier, you know, mercifully, it's short compared to most disaster films.
That is true. It is definitely short compared to your movie, but it's shorter compared to most modern disaster films, which tend to go, you know, like 2.5 hours.
But anything else you would like to throw in for Geostorm? I would just like to point out how much myself and Nicole have just held our heads during the first half of this episode.
I am literally holding my head right now.
And how much we will probably hold our heads during the second part of this episode. But it's just, yeah.
It's just, you know what I recommend? If anybody has the impulse to watch Geostorm, is you listen to How Did This Get Made? You listen to that episode on Geostorm. They did it for a live show. It is hilarious. It is infinitely more entertaining than the film Geostorm. And so I would watch that instead, because if you watch Geostorm, then your streaming service is going to start recommending some complete dreck to you. And mm-hmm. avoid at all costs. This is my worst of, because it was actively irritating and boring simultaneously.
Yeah. Okay, so let's wrap up Geostorm. we'll take a well-deserved break in proceedings and go and get some popcorn and some really hard drugs before we discuss my choice, and we'll be back in a second.
These movies are so bad, I am rage menstruating. So.
Lovely. Okay, so welcome to the intermission. This is the part of the episode where I pose a random question to my co-host and get their honest first answer. Nicole, are you ready?
Boy, these always throw me for a loop, but yes.
Well, this was on the fly. I didn't think of this too long before the start of the recording, but I thought it was quite an interesting one. It requires a little bit of explanation, but what is your favourite cinema experience?
Oh.
So this is maybe not something maybe not even a film that you particularly enjoyed but something that you experienced in a cinema that is very memorable to you.
Oh, no, I have
this. It might be a real...
Okay. I've got this right on the tip of my tongue immediately. I saw Mandy in... Okay. Like one of those old movie house movie theaters with a giant mm-hmm. like stage and proscenium arch and everything, with a giant midnight art house crowd. So we were all 100% down for whatever Panos Cosmatos wanted to throw our way. And we mm-hmm. were all in for the ride, I think every one of us. And I absolutely loved it. It was one of the greatest movie experiences I've ever had.
Wow. So, okay.
And cannot recommend highly enough, if you get a chance to see Mandy on a big screen at like a Repertory Theater or something, go, because it is a sensory experience on top of being a film.
I must admit, for one, I haven't seen Mandy. It's on my watch list to watch. I'm having a bit of a resurgence with Nicolas Cage at the moment, and enjoying some of his later work. So it is something that is on my watch list. But, I mean, I suppose you guys over there are a little bit more interactive, I suppose, with the cinema. You know, you applaud at the end of the films and you get more involved, and that's the impression that we get over here.
Sometimes. It depends on where, what city you're in, what part of the city you're in.
Right.
How primed the audience is for a particular film. You know, you go see, you know, one of the Star Wars films on opening night, you're going to get a lot of applause and yelling and that kind of thing. But if it's week three in East Overshoe, suburb of Bangor, Maine, it's not going to be quite as lively.
Okay. Well, I mean, I think we're, you know, those Brits are maybe just naturally that bit more stoic, I suppose, mm. than not as stoic as, you know, maybe a Japanese audience.
Yeah, but they're famous sort of British reserve.
Yeah, I suppose. But then, you know, my answer to that question would be, it was a very big marketing tool, sort of late 90s, early 2000s, where you would see these trailers for films and it would be, you know, interjected with audience reactions, night vision cameras of people jumping mm. and things like that.
Right.
And I'd never, ever experienced that. You'll get the odd person maybe jump, and I would jump and at certain horror films or thrillers or whatever mm. until I went to see The Descent. And that is the closest I've got to that experience, because yeah. everybody jumped in unison at various points during the film.
Yeah.
Spoilers, but there's obviously one point where the women that are down in the caverns, one of them swings around thinking that she's attacking one of these creatures and, you know, jabs a pickaxe through her friend's throat. And the loudest reaction I've ever heard in a cinema, there was a woman in front of everybody. She was on the front row, I think, just went, "Oh my God." And just the loudest thing I've ever heard in a cinema, and the loudest reaction I've heard to anything in a cinema. But just various points through that film, everybody jumping, everybody gasping, yeah. and everybody just in complete and utter shock. And it is the most memorable cinema experience I've ever had.
Very brave of you to see that one in a theater. So.
Oh, it was amazing.
Yeah.
Great film. Great film. But okay, so that's we'll call that the end of the intermission then, Nicole. Let's head back and see what's in store for us next.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so this is obviously an completely independent subject. This was chosen at random by the AI that is the random weird app that I have on my phone. And it took a little bit of research from me just to think, what sci-fi films have I actually seen that were released during the 2010s? And I had a few considerations. I think I sent them through to you. Really obvious one was Rise of Skywalker from the Star Wars series. But I thought that was a little bit too easy. And there are bits of that, very small chunks of that, that I enjoyed mm. and can not quite forgive the whole of the film, but
it was a hot mess.
Yeah. One of the other ones was X-Men Dark Phoenix, which has, you know, although it is a superhero comic book film, it's got a lot of sci-fi elements to it. Obviously, the main protagonists are aliens, or portrayed as aliens. But I went to something that was a real big disappointment for me. And that film was Independence Day Resurgence from 2016.
Ready for this. We used their technology to strengthen our planet. But it won't be enough.
I see them in my dreams. They're coming back.
Today, you will once again be fighting for our freedom. Not from tears. Oppression or persecution, but from annihilation.
ruin the day. The 4th of July will no longer be known as an American holiday, but as the day when the world declared in one voice, we will not go quietly into the night. We will not vanish without a fight.
Fall back!
Definitely bigger than the last one.
Directed by Roland Emmerich, who we've discussed already on this podcast. Starring Liam Hemsworth, Jeff Goldblum, Bill Pullman, Micah Monroe, Jesse T. Usher, Celia Ward, William Fichtner, and Brent Spiner, amongst others. There's a few others that you could throw into that.
It's a big cast, yeah.
It's almost an ensemble, although that sounds a bit too classy for this film. So two decades after the first Independence Day invasion, Earth is faced with a new extrasolar threat. Extrasolar? That doesn't sound right.
Outside the solar system.
Extrasolar threat. But will mankind's new space defences be enough? The answer is yes, by the way. Almost. But, you know, I've got a lot of love for the original Independence Day. I know it has its problems and it is very pro-America and, you know, you can throw a lot of those criticisms at it.
It's extremely cheesy.
Yeah, yeah. But for me, I went to see this at the cinema, and it's even at 13, this is the first film I remember going to see at the cinema with my dad. So it like a lot of films that I've discussed on this podcast, it holds a special place in my heart, or the original does. But it was just amazing to see 1996. We've never seen anything like this, really, in terms of mass destruction on a global scale. I don't think, anyway. Or I hadn't at that point. So I had a massive love for the original film, but not to go too much into that. This film is it doesn't touch it in any way at all. There's no nostalgia value in this film at all. Discuss with Geostorm, you have to suspend your disbelief that they can create this net around the world. And you've also got to suspend your disbelief that we've advanced our technology that much that we can fly so easily to the moon.
Well, this at least they have a reason. You know, we've been piggybacking on the alien technology that we got after the battle in 1996. So we've stolen and made hybrid tech from the aliens' technology.
Yeah, which, you know, yes, it makes sense that we've got access to that technology and we can harvest that in a way. But
I was just happy there was a reason.
But it doesn't. I think it goes too far. Mm. I think it advances things too much.
Right.
If this film had, you know, we've got a certain amount of defence and we're preparing for another alien invasion in the future. But then halfway through the film, it's like, actually, we've been working on this, which is much more advanced, that's going to help us. But it's not. It's like we've got, you know, these spacecraft can go from the Earth to the Moon really easily. And we've got these cannons that are supposed to be able to defend ourselves against a new alien threat.
Right.
But it's
it, the first movie, I mean, there are some things about it that are just ridiculous and over the top and cheesy and tropey, but it is a fun ride. just the same. Yeah. It's something that it makes you willing to give yourself over to it. Mm-hmm. To just go along for the ride. Say, yes, this part is bad, that part is bad, but I am having a good time watching what's going on here. I'm having a good time watching the White House blow up. I'm having a good time.
Yeah. But the stakes are right in that film. You know, they have these big ships that can cover a city and they destroy the planet one city at a time by just blowing everything up. Mm-hmm. Whereas this is this giant spaceship that covers a third of the planet and just sucks everything up into the air and then throws it back down. There's no stakes to that, almost. I think it's just...
It will kill us all.
Yeah, exactly. And it's... I was so disappointed with this film. I can't express. Because I was a massive fan of Independence Day. I thought it was a brilliant film. And I still think it does. I think it stands up. Apart from those criticisms that you could throw at it, I still think it's a great action, adventure, sci-fi film. Right. You know, it's...
You care about some of the characters.
Exactly. And this is the big problem with this film is that, you know, whether it's the cast or the characters, and I think it's a bit of both, the young cast don't have the charisma that the younger cast had in the original film.
Yes.
You've got Liam Hemsworth.
Second best Hemsworth.
The second best Hemsworth, who I certainly didn't care for. It's a non-part. You don't get on board with him. You're not rooting for him. He just comes across as a bit of an arsehole.
Mm.
There's this subplot with him and Dylan Hiller.
Is that sort of his shorter sidekick guy?
No, he's supposed to be the son of Will Smith.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Where he caused this accident that nearly killed Hiller, and he just doesn't... I just didn't care. I just didn't care that they have this relationship. And I think whatever you can throw at the original Independence Day, the best casting in that film is Will Smith.
Yes.
Will Smith was at his peak. He was becoming the megastar.
Yes.
He was easily the best thing in that film. He had all the right one-liners. He had the charisma. He was Will Smith in that film.
Yes, that was the era. His rise was in huge part to just absolutely undeniable star-making charisma.
Ooh.
You want to watch him. You're invested in what he's doing. You like his characters. You know, you're rooting for him the whole time.
And that's it. The biggest thing this film is missing is Will Smith.
Yeah.
You know, depending on what reports you read, he either was too expensive for this film or he was obliged to be making Suicide Squad.
Hmm.
So either way, we get no Will Smith. We get the character played by Jesse T. Usher, who is his son, who's the young lad in the first film. And he's made out to be, you know, sort of living in this shadow of Will Smith's character from the original. And past that, his character has nothing. He doesn't have any stakes in this film other than a very haphanded revenge because his mother, who was a stripper, who's now become a doctor. And
we're missing some context in between here. I would have liked a little exposition on how that happened. But,
you know, and her death scene is just thrown in there. It's like, you know, it's very, very loose that he would be close enough to be able to see that his mum can't get on this plane, and but then after that, there's nothing. It's all Liam Hemsworth. It's not. You've got to imagine that this film would have been started off with being written as including the Will Smith character from the original, and maybe some of that arc would have gone to his son from the original, but he's just sort of lost in the shuffle, and Liam Hemsworth is the main guy in this film, really.
He's sort of the central protagonist. I mean, Jeff Goldblum's a close second, but yeah, Liam Hemsworth is sort of the central protagonist, and that's... I don't think I've ever seen a film where he's the lead before. I think he does perfectly well as a supporting character in films that I've seen. You know, he was fine in The Hunger Games. He's good in Triangle. You know, he's...
Mm-hmm.
He's been fine, but I haven't seen anything where he's a lead, so I don't know if he can usually carry a film. I mean, he's trying. I'll give him credit. He really seems to be, you know, game for it and trying, but I don't think he's succeeding.
Yeah, no, I don't think he does at all. I didn't care. I couldn't have cared less if he'd have died in this film. Really, I think you could have negated that character completely if, you know, the Dylan Hiller character, Jesse T. Usher, could have been the love interest of Micah Monroe's character,
mm-hmm.
who's obviously the daughter of the former president, and you wouldn't have missed anything. It didn't need to be there. He's got no...
Right.
Other than the revenge angle for the fact that he's... I think the Dylan character just gets such a bad rap in this film.
It's not a good role. It's not written well.
No, because his father's died in this undisclosed experimental aircraft accident.
Right.
You know, it's very much brushed over. There's a bit of a picture of Will Smith out in the White House kind of thing.
We find out in the most awkwardly phrased question from a reporter.
Yeah.
I wrote it down. There's like a press conference going on about this legacy squadron leaving for the moon. And one reporter asks, considering he died during a test flight, how do you feel about taking off for the moon from a hangar named after your father?
Yeah. It's
sitting there, just... I'm like, number one, I'm a proofreader. And I'm like, why is there a pronoun before the antecedent? And second, it's just so awkwardly phrased.
Well, that's it. It's as insensitive as a lot of reporters can be, I don't think they would be that insensitive to ask that question in that style.
Yes, it's very blunt. You know, and when reporters are blunt, they generally will just flat out say, you know, your father died during a test flight. This hangar's named after him. How do you feel? You know, they're more matter of fact about it, I guess. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. And that's it. And I think this way that this film struggles is because it's got to, you know, no matter what you think of the original, the best thing in that film was Will Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to somehow... 20 years later, make this requel and just completely brush past that, because that's all they do, really. You know, it's very much just, that's it. Let's get on with the rest of the film. It just massively suffers from him not being there.
Yes.
And you think how much money is probably thrown at this film. You could have either afforded Will Smith or you could have afforded to wait for Will Smith.
Yeah, they put most of the humor on the Judd Hirsch character.
Yeah.
Which is a mistake because he's playing this exaggerated New York Jewish man.
Yeah. Yes and no. I think for me, Judd Hirsch is probably one of the better parts of this film, to a degree.
I'm not saying he's bad.
But then I think, whether it's a conscious decision, I don't know, but he's a lot less Jewish in this film.
I bet it's a conscious decision.
He's very Jewish in the first film, but that's what makes his character funnier, I think, in the first film. But the first film also has that religious element to it, in that
he's actually praying at points.
Yeah, exactly. So it makes sense, and it, in the end, it becomes relevant to the story of faith and praying and everything else. So, you know, maybe that was a conscious effort, but I think it's probably the most realistic thing in this film is that, you know, he would have written a book about how he saved the planet, and then, you know, he's just continuously trying to sell this book and reading it to people in an old folks home, trying to sell more copies. Right. But it's the only bit of heart that this film has. He takes on these lost children that have lost their parents and everything else, and it's the only real bit of heart I think that's in this film. And there's a lot more heart in the original than this one, and that's the only point I thought that was realistic in terms of heart for the picture.
I would agree with that. I think they try to put heart in with the relationship between Micah Monroe and Bill Pullman with the daughter-father dynamic. I think they really try a little artificiality by having what they call the Legacy Squadron, which I assume means that this group of pilots are all children of the pilots who fought the aliens the first time. I think that's the impression I had. I don't know. Otherwise, I don't know why it would be called a Legacy Squadron.
Possibly. Maybe it's just because they're headed up by Dylan Hiller.
Yeah. They shoehorn in a husband for the scientist character played by Brent Spiner.
Oh.
And it's like, yes, I want gay representation in the movie.
But it's just so, you can just tell it's written by somebody who has no knowledge it's just written by somebody who is writing, a straight person who's writing a gay relationship, I think.
That's entirely possible.
For me, and I'm not going to sit here and say that I could sit here and write a realistic gay relationship, because I'm not a gay man and I couldn't do that. But even as a heterosexual man, it's just cringeworthy. Every other word, every other line ends with babe.
Yes. They call each other babe.
And when you research the film, it was pointed out pre-production, there is going to be a gay couple in this film. Like it was ticking a box.
Mm-hmm.
And this, the representation of this couple is very much ticking the boxes.
Yeah. If you're going to have representation, you don't need to announce it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then this, you know, going back to some of the legacy characters, because I think that's, you know, the lexicon these days since Scream 5. Scream 5. Which we've recently christened Five Cream.
Okay.
Five Cream, which you'll hear on an upcoming episode. It's, you know, you've got Jeff Goldblum, who has turned into this sort of smug character since the original, and he brings very little of what made the David Levison character very likable in the original film.
I think all his characters are smug. I just think this one, he's phoning it in.
But I don't think the original David Levison character was particularly smug. This is more Jeff Goldblum just being Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
In this film. Bill Pullman is sort of half there, I think, in this. They try to make him look like he's been through the ringer and he's really struggling with the responsibility that he had in the original film and everything else, but that doesn't really stretch much further than messing up his hair and having a beard.
And his mental health is declining because somehow he's linked to the hive? Why?
Yeah, but then that, which is fair enough, because you have that connection in the first film, but then you're going to bring back a character that everybody thought was dead in Brent Spiner's character, and you're going to add this third character who wasn't in the original, this African, the son of an African warrior who also has this...
Warlord, which I did not love that the black character is the son of a warlord.
Of course.
The other black character other than, you know, Junior.
But you're going to throw in this third character that has this psychic connection to the aliens. Mm-hmm. So it almost makes Bill Pullman's character a little bit redundant in that fact.
Yes.
And if you have just kept him as this sole link, psychic link to the aliens, then it would have maybe been a bit more interesting. But, you know, he looks good for nearly 70 as well, Bill Pullman. He doesn't look to have aged since the original. I couldn't quite figure out how his Independence Day speech was broadcast to the entire galaxy. That was a bit of a stretch.
Oh, my God. I was so angry. I mean, number one, everything that we broadcast goes out from the Earth kind of equivalently.
Mm-hmm.
All in every direction, but they're ripping off contact at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
You hear his speech, you know, this is our independence. You hear that speech echoing as we're traveling away from the Earth. And I was so Contact is one of my favorite films, and it's one of my favorite books. And Carl Sagan was like my childhood hero. So, because I'm a nerd. And, but the ripping off, stealing from Robert Zemeckis' contact made me so upset. And even so, that limits like how far the aliens can be from us. They can only be, what, like 24 light years away or something to have received that and respond to it. So, I don't know.
But to round up the legacy cast, as we mentioned, you've got Vivica A. Fox, who's really sort of shoehorned into this story, you know.
Nothing to do.
No, you know, there is that leap that she was a stripper and she became a doctor. But she's there to be that anchor point, I suppose, for...
Nostalgia.
For
Oh, God.
Brent Spiner.
I wish listeners could see the defeated slump every time. Every time you sigh.
Throughout this film, it was just like, it's nice to see Brent Spiner doing something outside of the Star Trek universe.
Mm-hmm.
And he's good in this film. I think he's suitable for what his role is in this film. It's a massive stretch that he survived the first film. And yes, it's reasonably ambiguous, but it's a bit of a stretch, and you're sort of like, is he really needed? Is that character really needed in this film? Probably not. You could have given a lot of that to Bill Pullman's character if you don't really need it.
Or Jeff Goldblum for the science-y stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And poor old Robert Loggia.
Oh, Robert Loggia, yeah. He was dead when this movie came out.
He looks it.
He died in December of 2015, so I don't know if they shot anything with him or they just deep-faked him into this.
But it looks like it, and it's almost like, you know, yes, the film's dedicated to him and everything else, but is he really one of the most memorable characters from the first film that you need to sort of shoehorn in this little nod to him in this film?
You only see him for like 3 seconds anyway.
Yeah, and he looks like he doesn't know where he is.
Yes.
Which he probably didn't.
It's entirely possible. Assuming that's actually him.
It sounds horrible to say. And you're not going to have Will Smith in this film, but you're going to have Robert Loggia.
Yeah.
Aside from that, you know, you have
slumping again.
Bear with me. So one of the biggest parts of the original film is, you know, it's a film of two halves. It's almost like there's almost the Jaws comparison you can have to the film. You know, you have the first half of the film, which is the destruction of Earth and the spacecraft hovering over the major cities and destroying them. You know, the first part of Jaws, it's about the shark killing various people. And the second half of Jaws is very much the adventure and killing the shark and going after it and everything else. And the original film, the second half of that is very much about how we're going to defeat the aliens, and it becomes more of an adventure film. This film doesn't have that. It just has a very singular scene of this giant spacecraft that engulfs a third of the Earth, sucks everything up and throws it down. And this time London gets the brunt of it, basically, which was apparently a conscious decision to not have it. It was originally going to be Paris. It was originally going to be Paris, but there were terrorist attacks around that time.
Oh, okay.
So they decided to make it London. But the amazing visuals in that first one were all miniature, and there was very little CGI in terms of the destruction kind of things. Whereas this, it's all CGI, and you just cannot grasp what's going on.
No.
In all of those scenes, it's just, you just can't see it.
Right. And they're saying as it's arriving, which they predicted by all the people who are psychically linked to the aliens drawing pictures of a power button over and over again.
Christ almighty.
To predict that they're coming. We keep seeing this mysterious symbol. I'm like, it's a power button. It's a circle with a little line sticking out of it. It's a power button.
That's all just thrown in haphazardly as well, isn't it? You know, it's all like, there's this symbol, but it's not kept a mystery for the whole of the film.
No.
You know, it's fair enough if you're going to have that as a mystery for the whole film, that there's this symbol that we keep seeing, but we've only seen it between the first film and this film, so it's something that we're adding in post the original.
Right.
But we're going to tell you what it is within 10 minutes of showing you the first visions of that, or the first mention of it in the film. We're going to show you exactly what it is.
Right. No time for mysteries. It's time to get to the destruction.
But I will say that visual of it's the sort of swirl in space above the moon where this orb first comes through, and they think it's, you know, they attack it thinking it's the aliens. That's a really great visual. I thought that was really good. That was probably the best visual in the film. But like you mentioned earlier, once you watch the moon, it's exactly the same kind of bloody thing. It's just...
Moonfall.
Moonfall, sorry. I keep saying
Moon. Moon is a good movie. Duncan Jones' Moon is a good movie.
Moon is a great film, yes. Yeah.
But yeah, that's another thing that Moonfall steals from this movie is this thing is so big it has its own gravity. It has gravitational effects on the moon, which I guess would kind of make sense because they talk about how big it is, and it's literally, you know, two-thirds the size of the moon. And so, you know, I can kind of see that. But, you know, so you see, like, the small craft being sucked toward it. But yet when it's parked on the Earth, which is literally what it looks like, it doesn't even look like a bug that's landed on something. It looks like it's just parked on the Earth. The only effects that it seems to have is the tsunamis caused by the water displacement of it just sitting in parts of the ocean.
But that's it. You don't get that. You don't get that sort of global destruction that you had in the first one, even though this new spaceship is vastly bigger than anything that we've seen in the original film.
Right.
There's no stakes there. You don't feel... I didn't anyway. I didn't think, oh my God, this is just destroying everything, even though it takes the London Eye up into the sky and throws it down and, you know, the Houses of Parliament and everything else. I just didn't care. And I think that's probably the biggest criticism that you can throw at this film, is that I didn't care.
I think the problem is that it's too big.
Mm.
It is so big that it makes the planet look small.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's sort of a mental trick or illusion where you're, okay, so it's landed and it's on the planet, which is really small. And so somehow to me, it makes it feel like less of, I don't know. It makes it seem too unreal because it's too big to conceive of.
This big craft can destroy the entirety of London, but the ship with the pirates on that are right next to where it's drilling are not affected by it.
Yeah, that seemed kind of odd. If it's powerful enough to drill toward the core of the Earth, one would think that there would be a bigger radius of radiation or heat or something.
But we also get this global representation of how it's affecting the rest of the world, because we see Arabs and Buddhist monks. You know, that's the representation of the entire world when it comes to Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin is Asia.
Yes. Yeah. You also have the token Chinese pop star worked in as one of the pilots. It's Angela Baby, who I know from two fun little meta martial arts movies called Tai Chi Zero and Tai Chi Hero.
All right.
And those are entertaining. But so I'm like, I know that face. And I looked her up. Oh, yeah, there's Angela Baby. And then I'm just like, with a name like Angela Baby, she's a singer, right? I'm like, yeah, it's a Chinese pop star that they're sticking in here. So to be a love interest of Liam Hemsworth's best friend, I don't know the name of the actor.
Mm.
He's smitten.
He's poor substitute for Harry Connick Jr. in this film.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Harry Connick Jr. has much more charisma. I think my biggest problem with this movie, sorry, just because this comes in early, so I wanted to bring it up, is they talk about there's an alien prison in Area 51. And then Charlotte Gainsbourg is doing research on these people in Africa who are followers of this warlord who have been, quote, fighting a ground war against the aliens for the last 10 years. And it's like, wait, I thought they all died at the end of the first Independence Day. I thought by shutting down the hive and killing the mothership, you know, all the ships fell out of the sky. So presumably all the pilots and everything, they just dropped out of the sky. So they all died, right? Where are those aliens coming from?
Well, no, because we establish in this film, if they fail in their mission, they return to the mothership galaxies away.
So it's just this inherent giant contradiction that they do not deal with.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I think it is.
It's a bad retcon.
It's a very sickly part of this film, is that you've got this subplot with this African warlord and his son. I forget the character's name, but he's just sort of reduced to this comic relief as well of the film. And you know, he sort of buddies up with the weak link in the cast, and
the bureaucrat. Yeah,
yeah, and it's just so really, it's just really sickly, and just doesn't. You know, you've got a really good representation in the original of Will Smith. He's a young black actor, and he's this really strong presence in the film, and he's a good representation of black.
He's smart. He's good at his job.
Yeah, exactly. And in this, you know, the Dylan character is just reduced to a bit of a sidekick, really.
I'm trying to get out of my father's shadow.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of thing. Which is just so tired. Yeah. Such a tired trope.
Exactly. And that's what I mean. If, you know, you could get rid of the Liam Hemsworth character if he'd had that relationship with the Micah Monroe character, daughter of the president. You know, they knew each other from before.
Also a pilot.
Exactly. You don't need that Liam Hemsworth character at all in this film. And all of that subtext of the film could have been given to him rather than the Liam Hemsworth character that he's, you know, he's in love or he's, you know, he's engaged to Micah Monroe's character. But he's just sort of fizzled down to, he's lost both his parents. You know, he's lost his, mm-hmm. his dad, he's lost Will Smith in this tragic accident with a test aircraft, and he's lost his mum to not being able to get quickly enough onto a helicopter or whatever that thing is supposed to be.
And he's close enough to watch her die personally.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you know, he's conveniently there enough, you know, close enough to watch her die. Yeah. And I think, again, that's another point that this film misses out on that the original had. It had a lot of heart to it. You know, one of the big pieces of that was in the original was the Randy Quaid character, the Russell Case character in the original. He's this alcoholic father. He's got young children without a mother, and he's, you know, he has this trajectory in the original film where he stops drinking and he wants to, and he makes the ultimate sacrifice in that film. Right. And that's not even referenced in this film at all. And I think it's one of the better parts of the original. It's an interesting dynamic. The kids don't respect him, and he wants to save them, and that's the last thing he can do to make sure that he's doing something.
Be a good dad.
To be a good dad, yeah, exactly. And it's not even referenced. No, none of those kids are in this film.
No. They could have named the moon base after him.
Yeah, exactly. But it's the same with the Micah Monroe character. You know, her mum died, was the one of the sacrificial lambs in the first film. She dies, and that sort of spurs people on, and she's left without a mother. And then by the end of this film, she's left without a father.
Yeah.
Because he's making another sacrifice. And it was just... You're making sacrifices for the sake of making sacrifices.
Yes.
The same with the Vivica A. Fox character.
It is an attempt to forcibly yank on the heartstrings.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly it. And the same with, you know, they kill off Dr. Oaken's partner.
Yeah.
As well. And it's just not needed. It's just... You don't need to raise those stakes more than the world ending.
Exactly.
And that's what this film is all about. You know, the aliens, the CGI for the aliens is far too much. I think, you know, the Star Wars prequels did this well, you know, especially Force Awakens. You know, any CGI or the alien characters were they either made with CGI to look like they were makeup effects, or they were, you know, special effects and they were, you know, real creatures.
And they did not rip off the Queen from Aliens.
Well, you've got this kaiju-sized Queen that's meant to be orchestrating everything, and it's just... It's just far too over the top, far too over the top. And, you know, the original physical aliens in the original film, I thought were really creepy and they looked really good. But it's...
I actually kind of liked the kaiju-sized queen. I mean, just because I wasn't expecting it, for one. Just because the ship is gigantic doesn't mean that the being inside of it has to be gigantic. But I was just like, oh, okay. I was not expecting a gigantic space bug to, you know, be coming to attack. This is different. So, I mean, that part was okay, but it's just in her giant ship that's not causing any gravitational or tectonic issues, you would think that would be a problem.
Yeah.
Just the weight of it sitting on various fault lines.
Well, I think where this film really suffers is that, you know, you're carrying on a story from 20 years ago.
Yes.
And you're always going to struggle with how far do you go forward and how far do you keep it back enough to be some kind of semblance to the original. And I think this film goes too far the other way. And it doesn't have that familiarity to the original. I don't think.
Yeah, it's got an entirely different feel to it. I'm not sure how to articulate it, but it's other than cynical cash grab.
Yeah, but it also has this sort of element of the future. You know, obviously there were planned sequels to this film. Obviously you have this subplot with this sphere that looks like the head of Marvin the Paranoid Android.
Yes, it speaks definitely does.
Very much like it. It's sort of this Siri sphere that's very monotone and kind of tries to sort of fill in a lot of gaps of, you know, we're building this army to defeat these aliens, but you guys are the best bet that we've got because you've defeated them before and you sort of defeat them this time. It's very, very loose.
I'm from a race with much more advanced technology than yeah. you, and yet all of my people got wiped out.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So it's very...
But we're going to leave it to you.
Yeah, it throws in so many different angles and just doesn't work on a lot of different levels.
Yeah.
And there isn't that familiarity with the original, I don't think. And that's probably the biggest criticism you can throw at this film is that you don't have those stakes because we've got the technology or the humans are portrayed as having that technology. And yes, halfway through the film, they arrive and just wipe out the whole moon base and everything else. But, you know, we're sort of made to believe that we've developed our weaponry enough to match theirs. But we haven't matched their force field because their weapons can penetrate their own force fields, but ours, which is based on their technology, can't penetrate theirs.
Yeah. Yeah. And to be fair, they've had, you know, like 25 years to advance that beyond what we stole, so.
But that's it. I think if you had that sort of, yes, we've got this base sort of, we're getting ready for them coming back. We've defeated them before. We'll do it again. They've come back. It's bigger. It's better. Yes, we're up against it. We need to find another way to do it. You could have then thrown in halfway through the film, actually, at Area 51 or another secret installation, we've been working on their technology and we've got something that we can start to fight back kind of thing.
Right.
That would have probably worked a lot better than, yes, we've advanced so far that we've got floating platforms for the media and everything else at these Independence Day celebrations and stuff like that. Yeah.
I don't love that the resolution is because we didn't think before to use the Resident Evil strategy and get around and hit him at the vulnerable spot on their back and shoot at that a whole bunch and then they'll die.
Yeah.
So it's...
Because of course she's, you know, the Alien Queen's got her own force field flak jacket.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, if you've got it, why not use it? But you know, it's, I don't love the sexism in this movie. You know, like, yes, Micah Monroe is a fully qualified pilot, but by all means, let's let this guy in his 60s, who's becoming increasingly detached from reality, fly the plane instead of the woman who is more recently trained on the current technology. And when they're coming back from winning the battle, you know, there'll be eight pilots walking back. Two of them have their flight suits unzipped, and it's the two women, so that they're wearing their tank tops, and everyone else zipped up to the chin.
And I'll tell you what else Independence Day Resurgence has that Geostorm doesn't have. It's an X-Files connection. I had to search for this. This was a tough one. I didn't think it would be, but it was quite a tough one. And it's a very loose one. So Patrick S. Esprit, who plays the Secretary of Defense in this film, he was a guard in the very last episode of The X-Files, or the original run of The X-Files, called The Truth in Series 9.
Okay, so he played a guard in one the last episode of The X-Files and was probably like also a waiter at the time, would be my guess. But yeah, that's... And what is Charlotte Gainsbourg doing in this movie?
I know. Well,
what
you know,
the actual hell?
Yeah. You know, a couple of years earlier, she was cutting off bits of her own anatomy and talking to foxes, but...
Yeah, it's like this woman is in Lars von Trier movies, and... why? Why is she in this? I'm just like, must have had a house payment.
Yeah.
That's all I can think. Must have had a house payment due.
Yeah.
Got to pay those French taxes. So.
Yeah. But that's enough of this. Both of these films are terrible. To wrap things up, I would say I was more depressed watching My Choice than yours. And I think where Geostorm, you know, it's merciful in the fact that it's, what, an hour, hour and 40-something minutes. It's you know, it doesn't outstay its welcome, whereas, you know, this Independence Day Resurgence really outstays its welcome and, you know, probably more than 20 years outstays its welcome. And I'm glad that they didn't. It performed so poorly that they couldn't make any more.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's, you are running a real risk when you make a sequel decades after the original. You had better bring it. Yeah. You've had this long to write the perfect sequel to this film. And this is what you come up with.
Exactly. Well, that's it. It's that you've got to find that middle ground with not going too far that you lose everything from the original, which this film does, but still maintaining what made the original enjoyable again, which this film doesn't. It just sits somewhere in the middle of being terrible.
Yeah. Yeah.
Slap bang in the middle of being awful.
I would say so.
And that's it. I mean, if you're going to sit here and say the worst science fiction film of the 2010s, it's a 10-year period, there are probably X amount of absolutely terrible science fiction films, you know.
Right. I didn't see Battleship. I didn't see any of the Transformers movies.
But
I didn't see, what's the supposedly horrible one? Mortal Engines.
Yeah.
So.
But you've also got, when you talk about the worst films, you've got to take into account things like expectations. You would have an expectation of this being better than it was. The same with Geostorm. You know, you've got Dean Devlin attached to it. You've got Gerard Butler.
Right.
You've got big action, destruction, epic world destruction and things like that. So you would expect them to be better than they are. And, you know, you're not going to throw in something like an asylum film that's, you know, science fiction based or whatever, because you're not expecting them to be good.
Right.
You're expecting them to be that kind of film, whereas right. these, the expectation is a lot higher for these films. And you know, you can throw, I think you even suggested things like Prometheus,
yep.
which falls exactly into that category. You expect, I mean, I enjoy Prometheus. I don't think it's a terrible film, and
I enjoyed parts of Prometheus.
Exactly, and I wouldn't throw it into this conversation per se, because there are parts of it that are really good, and it really suffered from it, almost like this film, I suppose. It didn't connect enough to the Alien franchise, but it tried to avoid connecting it and being an actual prequel.
Right. It wasn't the idea to make it a prequel, no. but the studio pretty much forced that. So,
I mean, Prometheus, I don't think was the worst. I think it was disappointing, but there were some good things about it. This, you know, Geostorm and Independence Day Resurgence, they had these colossal budgets. They had casts that, while not always the best of the best, are, you know, decent. Mm-hmm. They're not like the cast of Atlantic Rim, say, mm-hmm. from Asylum.
Yeah.
You know, you're getting several levels up from there. But the main problem is it's very difficult to get one of these, you know, blockbuster disaster movies, because they get so focused on rendering the disasters mm-hmm. that you lose all human connection.
Yeah.
And the original Independence Day, at least, you had some human connection because you had these massively charismatic actors in it. You know, like Bill Pullman is intensely likable.
Yeah.
As a person. He just seems like a good guy. Yeah. You know? And Jeff Goldblum has charisma, and Will Smith has charisma by the ton. It's just, this is...
Well, that's it.
It's disappointing. It's so disappointing.
The original took that time to build that around this alien invasion, yes. whereas this is like...
You have a build-up, more of a build-up.
It's almost like they thought, we don't need to do that because we did it 20 years ago.
Mm. Let's just jump right to it.
And we'll just throw in a bigger spaceship and
more guns.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But I would love to see them make a disaster movie where they take the time to develop the script.
Yeah.
And the characters. Please, please, please. That would be so nice.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to see a smart disaster movie.
Yeah, it would be good. It would be good. But there we go. A lot of connections there, you know, obviously, in terms of the filmmakers.
They're similar in a lot of ways.
You know, they're both disaster films, one way or another. But yeah, quite a fun discussion, I think, that. I think it was...
Bad movies, not fun to watch, but fun to talk about.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, there we go. Is there anything, Nicole, that you'd like to let people know how to get hold of you or follow you on anything?
I am on Letterboxd at Nicole_Davis. I've got some updates to do on there, but I've got some top 10 lists from the past several years, if you have any interest in that.
Oh, I do like a good top 10 list. Okie dokie. So, yeah, that's about wraps us up then for our first. And thank you again for being the guinea pig for our Wheel of Misfortune, as this episode has kind of turned out to be. But, Because you're sort of free for at least three episodes now from falling into that. When next time comes around, Nicole, it'll be down to you to pick a subject for us. So we look very much forward to seeing what you can throw my way. And it just leaves me to say thank you and goodbye, and leaves you to say...
General Adams, the Earth's core is secure.